Hello everyone, welcome to commerce classes. From today onwards we shall be studying liquidation of companies, that is a procedure for closing of the companies. Now the contents of this chapter are: number 1, liquidation, that is the meaning, modes of winding up or liquidation, their circumstances and procedure. Second is appointment of company liquidators and his role. Like in case of companies, when they go into liquidation, then a liquidator is appointed either by the company or by the tribunal. So how the appointment takes place, or what type of persons can be appointed as company liquidators, and what is their role in the liquidation proceedings. Then we have certain important concepts which are relevant for liquidation of the companies, that is when we are in the process of closing the books of the company and realizing all the assets and paying all the liabilities, then certain things must be known to us which are otherwise not familiar to us when we are working for, say, liquidation of firms, that is usually referred as realization or closing of the firms. So it's a different process. So we need to know a certain terms in this case, like list of contributories, what are the financial matters, what are preferential payments, then pari passu clause and overriding preferential payments. These are certain things which we need to know so that we can understand the procedure of payment of the liabilities. After understanding the basic things regarding the liquidation of the companies, which are the main concepts involved here, we will be working for preparation of the statements. Now there are two main statements which are to be prepared as a part of this chapter in our course. Number one is statement of affairs and second is liquidator's final statement of accounts. So these are two statements which are prepared. The first statement is prepared when the company starts the proceedings of liquidation, that is it applies for liquidation or the tribunal passes the order for liquidation. So this is in the beginning, so it is a basically statement based on estimates, and then liquidator proceeds with the liquidation work. He starts the realization of assets, then he uses the money to pay off all the liabilities, and then finally he comes up with his final statement. So final statement is based on the actual amounts recovered and actual payments being made, whereas statement of affairs is an estimated statement. So we make an estimate, like this is the amount that we are going to recover from the assets and this will be used to pay off the liabilities in this order. So this is just an estimated statement, and the actual things which take place during liquidation, the actual working, actual payments, they are finally disclosed by the liquidators in the final statement of accounts. So these are two main practical questions that we are to handle. Within this, we need to calculate liquidators' remuneration also. So there are certain separate provisions applicable for the remuneration of liquidators. And these three are theory. Of course, the third concepts is equally important, because we need to know these terms and these concepts when we are to pay to the liabilities through our statement or through our final statement of accounts, right? So these two are very important from practical point of view, and the first two is the theory, as this is a chapter which has recently been included in our syllabus of BCom honors. So we are not very sure whether we'll be getting a theory question or a practical question, so we need to focus both on the theory as well as on the practical aspects. So let us start with liquidation, its meaning and mode, and appointment of company liquidator and his role, right? So starting with liquidation. Now you see, liquidation is basically a process of winding up of the company. Like we know that company is an artificial legal person, that is company is a person in the eyes of law, and we all know how a company is created. It is created through certain provisions as per the Companies Act. So when a company comes into existence, comes into life through the legal provisions, then its life can also be ended only through the legal provisions. So liquidation or winding up is the process of bringing life of the company to an end. So when it is decided that the company is to be closed, then the procedure which is followed at that time to bring an end to the life of the company. That procedure is called liquidation or winding up. So as per Companies Act definition, winding up of a company means winding up under the act. That means a company can be wound up either under the Companies Act 2016 by the tribunal under two section 70 of the act. So there is one way of going for the winding up of the company through the tribunal. So there is a tribunal being set by the government and the company can be liquidated through the tribunal, and here in this case Companies Act 2013 provisions are applicable. Or another method is liquidation under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Now in this case, the proceedings for liquidation starts by the company itself, and when we say by the company, it means by the company's directors and its member shareholders. So a company can be wound up in two modes. There are two ways in which a company can be wound up. So modes of winding up, which are given in the definition itself, these are by the tribunal under section 270 of the Companies Act, and another is voluntary liquidation under section 59 of Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. So these are the two ways in which we can go for winding up of the company. This is 2013. Our present act is 2013. Now let us start with these two modes one by one. I'm giving you the modes parallel so that we can understand the differences between the two modes, and we can also understand the procedure involved therein. Starting with first one, by the tribunal. Now when the winding up is to be done by the tribunal, it means that there is an authority which is giving an order for the winding up of the company, or which is being consulted, or a query is raised to the tribunal for the winding up of the company. So how can we have the case of tribunal passing the order? Now there are certain circumstances when the tribunal under section 270 of the Companies Act can pass order for the company to be dissolved. Number one is by special resolution of the company. So a company itself can resolve that it should be wound up. There may be many reasons for the same. Maybe that the member shareholders are not willing to continue with the same, or the particular event for which the company was set up, or as per the articles, the company is to be liquidated on the happening of certain events or on the completion of certain terms. So if something of that kind has happened, then by passing a special resolution, company can apply to the tribunal. Second is if the company has acted against interest of sovereignty and integrity of India. That means company is doing some sort of activities which are against our national interest, our security, our relations with the foreign states, foreign countries, or it is simply against the public order or decency, etc. So when a company is acting against the interest of the country or of its foreign relations, etc., then also the tribunal can pass an order. So in this case, the government or an appointed person approved by the government will apply or file a petition, because when we make application to the relevant authorities, we say that we are filing a petition. So they can file a petition with the tribunal to pass order for the company to be wound up. Although in this case, company will be given an opportunity to be heard. Then on the application by the registrar or any person authorized by central government, this is central government, if the tribunal is of the opinion that company's affairs are being conducted in fraudulent manner. So you see, if on all the companies there is a controlling authority called registrar. So if the registrar finds that company affairs are being conducted in a fraudulent manner, or company is formed for unlawful or fraudulent purposes, or it is found that the people who are concerned with the formation and management of the company, they are guilty of fraud or misconduct, then the registrar can also apply to the tribunal for the company to be wound up. Another is that when a company makes a default in filing with the registrar its financial statements and annual returns. Like the companies are required to file their annual statements with the registrar regularly. So if a company makes a default in filing with the registrar their statements and returns for 5 years consecutively, then also the registrar can file an application with the tribunal for the company to be dissolved. And finally, suo motu also, a company can be dissolved by the tribunal if the tribunal is of the opinion that it is fair and equitable to wind up the company. That may have something to do with the business of the company, or it may be the way in which the company's affairs are being managed. So due to any reason, if tribunal finds it is fair and equitable to wind up the company, they can also pass an order. But in this case, the company will be given an opportunity to be heard. Right. So these are the 5 circumstances when the tribunal can pass an order for winding up of the company. So who can file the petition? Like we found the cases. So like here in this case, when the company is passing a resolution, so obviously company will file petition for the winding up. If company is acting against the interest and sovereignty of the country, so central government or any person authorized by them can file a petition with the tribunal. If the registrar is finding these facts or the company is making default in filing returns, so registrar can also file the petition. So the petition for the liquidation of the company can be filed by these three, any of these three. Petition by company. Now when a company files a petition for it to be dissolved, then this petition must be accompanied with a statement of affairs. Like in the contents of the chapter, I discussed a statement of affair, which is a preliminary statement explaining how the assets are going to be collected and payments are to be made. So this petition must be accompanied with a statement of affairs, and a copy of the petition must be submitted to the registrar. And when the copy is submitted to the registrar, registrar is to give his opinion on this issue within 60 days of receipt of petition. So here in this case, when company files for petition for the insolvency, then the tribunal will decide on the merit of the case, of course after consulting the registrar, whether the company should be dissolved or not, and accordingly an order will be passed. Another is petition by contributories. Contributories are basically the shareholders or members of the company. So if a person is the original allottee of the shares, or he has got the shares from the original allottee after his death, or the person is holding shares for at least 6 months during the 18-month period preceding the winding up application, then such contributories can also file a petition with the authority, that is tribunal. And finally, petition by the registrar. So registrar can also file the petition after obtaining sanction of central government. So central government of course will give time to the company to present the case. So registrar can also file the petition. Right. Now, second mode of liquidation of the company is voluntary liquidation. So voluntary liquidation is when the company itself decides that it should be dissolved, it should be liquidated. Now when a company goes for voluntary liquidation, then there are 2 conditions attached to this. Only those companies which are fulfilling these 2 conditions, they are eligible to opt for voluntary liquidation. The conditions are, number 1, the company is either having no debt or it is having sufficient assets to pay off its debt. Secondly, company is not being liquidated to defraud any person. So these provisions wherein the company itself is going for liquidation, these are applicable just to ensure that the people behind the company, they are not using the company to defraud any person or to avail any kind of fraudulent benefits out of the company. Like the management or the director's team, they might have taken huge loans from banks, and now when the time comes to pay and they have misappropriated the money, so they apply for voluntary liquidation. So they cannot do so in this case, because either the company, the condition says either the company should have no debt or it should be in a position to pay off its debt. Secondly, it should not be liquidated to defraud any person. Now, given these two conditions being fulfilled, then a company can apply for voluntary liquidation. Voluntary means on its own. Now, the requirements are as per the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. Since you are applying for liquidation under Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code, so the company needs to follow all the procedures and requirements as specified by the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Board of India. And the basic requirements are, number one is condition for voluntary liquidation. Now, when a company goes for voluntary liquidation, then they need to give a declaration of solvency. Like here in the first condition is company should not have any debt or it should be in a position to pay off the debt. So, when you are able to pay off your debts, you are called solvent. So, here in this case, when you apply for voluntary liquidation, you need to give a declaration of solvency and a declaration that the aim is not to defraud any person. So, the two conditions which are to be fulfilled, for these conditions, company's directors, majority of the directors need to give the declaration in writing. Further, when you are applying for voluntary liquidation, you need to give your audited financial statements, your record of business operations for at least 2 years, and a report on valuation of assets. That is, the assets will be fetching up how much price and how the company is going to pay off the debts. Another thing is a resolution, because company is deciding about the voluntary liquidation, then who is in the company? It means the shareholders. So, a resolution in the favor of voluntary winding up, it can either be a special or an ordinary resolution. When a company is to be wound up after completion of the specified time duration as per articles, or on the happening of certain events as per the articles, then a ordinary resolution is needed, otherwise a special resolution is needed. Secondly, a resolution for appointment of insolvency professional, that is a liquidator. So the company, when they are deciding or resolving to liquidate themselves as per the voluntary liquidation procedures, then they need to pass a resolution for the appointment of insolvency professional or liquidator also. So within that, they need to decide about the liquidator, and this can be done within 4 weeks of filing the original application. Another is that if you have debt, of course the directors are giving a declaration of solvency, but along with that a resolution by the creditors representing 2/3 of the debts approving the above resolution. So you need to have a resolution from the creditors also, who are representing 2/3 of the total creditors, and this must reach within 7 days of company's resolution, otherwise it is of no value. Now, there is one thing very interesting. When we are studying liquidation proceedings, then throughout the procedures we will be using a term called creditors, and herein the term creditor basically does not imply the creditor that we usually use in the trading sense. The term creditor here implies all type of liability holders. All external liability holders are clubbed into creditors. Now, once these resolutions have been passed, so you apply for the voluntary insolvency as per the code. You need to notify to the registrar within 7 days of company's resolution and creditor's resolution. So once you have resolved, that means the company has passed the resolution and you have got a resolution from the creditors, then within 7 days, registrar must be notified for the same. And then the procedure of voluntary liquidation starts. After that, once the procedure is over, that means the liquidator has realized all the assets, they have paid off all the liabilities, then an application is made to the adjudicating authority for the dissolution of the company, which in this case is registrar again. Then the order is passed by the authority that this company stands dissolved, and a copy of the authority, whichever has been set by the central government, it will be sent to the registrar within 14 days. So this is how a company can be dissolved, either through the tribunal or voluntarily through the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Court. Now, when a company is to be dissolved, it implies that if the order is passed either under the insolvency and bankruptcy court or the order is passed by the tribunal for the dissolution of the company, then from the same date, that is from the date of the order, all the affairs of the company needs to be closed. It also implies a termination letter for all the employees and workmen. That means the company is no longer into business. Of course, there is a exception to this. If it is necessary for the company to continue with the business to realize the assets profitably, then they can work. So suppose on say 30th of June, company applies for the dissolution or for the liquidation, and in say first week of July, order is also passed. Now when the order is passed, then from that date, the company is to close all the business. Because the liquidation is likely to take maybe 1 month, 2 months, 3 months period. Now company is not to carry on the business, it ends on that day. But if it is of the opinion, the liquidator is of the opinion that the company needs to continue with the business so that it can realize assets profitably, then the business can be continued. So in that case, even after passing of the order of liquidation, to the extent necessary, the company will continue with the business, and afterwards the business will be dissolved, because as soon as you have realized your assets, you won't be having anything to work on. So obviously the business will be closing down in the phased manner. Now, irrespective of the manner in which the company is to be liquidated, company needs to appoint a company liquidator. So company liquidator basically implies a person who has been appointed to carry on all the activities of liquidation. Like when we dissolve a firm, what happens at the time of dissolution of a firm? Someone is made responsible to sell off all the assets, collect the money. Then that money is used to pay off the liabilities as per their preference order and proportion. So, here also a liquidator is to be appointed for the same. Now, in case of voluntary liquidation, the company decides about the liquidator. So the members can nominate any person from the panel of chartered accountants, cost accountants, legal experts, or company secretaries, as the list is prepared by the central government. So according to the listed professionals, as per the central government, the shareholders or the members can nominate company liquidator. And along with the nomination, they will also specify the terms and conditions of the liquidator's appointment and his remuneration. Now, on the other hand, when the company is to be liquidated by the tribunal, then it is the responsibility of the tribunal to appoint the official liquidator. So here in this case, the person appointed is called official liquidator. Now, official liquidator is appointed by the tribunal from the panel of professionals prepared by the central government. And the panel of professional includes chartered accountants, cost accountants, company secretaries, or legal experts, or any professional body with at least 10 years of experience in their field. Now, when the tribunal is passing an order for the appointment of liquidator, then the company, a provisional liquidator, is appointed, and later on with the final order for the liquidation, the same provisional liquidator is then made the official liquidator. Now, liquidator has a right to form a committee for winding up of the company. So it is not that liquidator is working alone for all the processes. He can form a committee. That committee will include, of course, himself, the official liquidator, plus a creditor's nominee, plus any other person from the approved list of the professionals. So now the whole committee will work for the dissolution or for the liquidation proceedings. So all the committee meetings will be held under the chairmanship or convenership of the official liquidator, and the official liquidator will supervise the whole work of liquidation. So this is company liquidator, either appointed by the tribunal or by the company itself. Thank you.